All right, good afternoon, everyone. And thank you for staying back for this transfer pricing panel. There are three trends that are happening in India and three trends that are happening globally in transfer pricing. For globally speaking, if we see last few years, DMP, that is BEPS Action Plan 8 and 10 has been operationalized. ALP, arm's length price, is under tremendous pressure. There is a discussion on the market jurisdiction approach, and over the last 3 days, we saw a number of panels touching upon this point as well. And the latest elephant in the room is the unified approach, the new ABC of profit allocation and the nexus. So these are really the three big things that are happening on transfer pricing globally. Back home in India, there are certain fundamental changes that have taken place, particularly in the transfer pricing assessments. The risk-based assessments have reduced at least the quantum of TP cases, and that has a trickle-down effect on the cases that go before DRP and then to the tribunal. We don't know how the faceless assessment will play out for the transfer pricing, but that's one more area which will be significant in the years to come. APA has been a great success story in India, 300 plus APAs, and big hand to Ashish ji and the entire team. That has really helped get a certainty on number of issues. As I said, 300 plus APAs in such a short span of time is a record in itself. IT82 has, I think many of the disputes on comparables and so on are behind us. And the third focus is focus on the value creation, and there's a big area that particularly will be relevant from the next year is GAR, that is General Anti-Avoidance Rules. So how GAR and transfer pricing will play out is again going to be very, very critical. So we are going to discuss three or four themes that we have in the next 45 minutes that have been allocated to us, and we have a fantastic panel representing the industry revenue, global perspective. We also have a view from the from a senior advocate in Supreme Court. And of course, Mr. Ostwal, who's in fact wrote the paper on transfer pricing, which resulted in the transfer pricing legislation in India. So he's seen the whole life cycle of the TP legislation in India. So the first theme that we are going to discuss, and as I said, it was touched upon already over last 2 days, is there is a tremendous pressure on ALP, arm's length price, and there is a discussion on alternate, whether there should be a formula-based approach to the transfer pricing. And we have our panelists who have certain thoughts, but before that, I wanted your thoughts, having listened to the conversation on ALP versus formula-based approach. What do you think, which is a better approach? So can we have the poll question? And I request everyone, please everyone, to give their thoughts. The more votes we get, I think it will be a better reflective perspective as well. Which options do you prefer under ALP 2.0? Continue with arm's length, shift to formula-based apportionment, combination of ALP and formula-based allocation? Great, so 57% saying combination of ALP and formula-based allocation. Mr. Williams, yesterday we heard Mr. Akhilesh Ranjan saying that the new ABC approach, the unified approach, is a timid response, and he called for a overhaul of the arm's length principle. What's your take? You've been with the OECD's BEPS project. You've also been part of the UK HMRC. Which of the three options would you prefer going forward?
Well, I think maybe the most interesting thing is the Indian jury's reaction to what Akhilesh Ranjan said, where the voting for the combination of the two, and I think probably that's where we will end up, for a number of reasons. you know, it seems to me there's formulary apportionment and there's formulary apportionment. You know, if you have profit splitting in an APA, then there's a formula there that tells you how to fit to split the profits, but it's a bespoke formula tailored to the specifics of that particular business. And it seems to me that that's quite different from a general, what I would call one-size-fits-all formula in the sort of formula apportionment that some of the sort of leading exponents of it press for. And I think that that's, in a sense, a difficulty with overall formula apportionment. It's easy to say you favour it, but how do you reach agreement and what are the factors in the formula? And can you still sustain that agreement when you start debating that? And I suspect it's a bit difficult. I think it's a bit like the debate you had in a country like New Zealand when they wanted to swap their flag. You know, there was a majority for swapping the flag, but nobody could agree what different flag they wanted instead. So they stuck with the one they got. And I suspect you can see that sort of dynamic here. I mean, to go back though to some of the fundamentals, I think it is significant that pillar one of the work program moves away from the arm's length principle and from entity by entity transfer pricing. Equally, I think it's fair to say that reflects a fairly strong level of dissatisfaction in some significant countries, including India, including the UK. But you know, as we were rightly reminded yesterday, there are also quite a lot of countries who are actually pretty happy with where we are now, and they will have to be part of the consensus as well if we're going to make progress. And I think, you know, given that, given the challenges of reaching agreement, we are going to end up with in effect, what people have voted for, a combination of the arm's length principle and some sort of formula, probably in the circumstances where people perceive that the existing ALP produces the least defensible results. Certainly, I think it's the case that for us, the A component in ABC still has to reflect value creation. And as I said yesterday, it has to solve the digital question. But I think in terms of practitioners who are more bothered perhaps about how you apply the solution than precisely the terms of it, I think there are two important points. First, it's got to be clear how A, B, and C fit together. And I think that the Secretariat does a good job at making the first go at that in the consultation document. But I think people will need to be clear, you know, if bits don't seem to fit together, then the consultation is the opportunity to flag that. Equally, I think we need to be clear how A, B, and C fits with the existing transfer pricing rules. And of course, a difficulty there is that not all countries have signed up to the same rules. But again, If we're going to be clear about how the rules apply in future, we will need to be clear how we deal with that dissonance as well.
Right. Ashish ji, you know, on this approach, whether the arm's length or formula-based apportionment, from a tax administration point of view, when we talk about ALP 2.0 future of transfer pricing, what would you prefer to be a right approach? Of course, we are waiting for the global consensus, but having worked on the ground on the APA in the transfer pricing side, which approach do you think will work better in the years to come?
Again, like Akhilesh sir said, or what the jury itself is saying, one thing is very clear, that unified approach document which has come up, it appears to be more of a last minute attempt to somehow cling to ALP. Probably why? Because for last 70, 80 odd years, we have continued with it, and that's why it has created an interest in continuing the same. But even if you see that paper in at least minimum three times, it says that there are administrative complexities, the ALP has created many problems. So it admits the problems are there, but still it doesn't want to lose what India and other similar market economies have been stating, that it's a lopsided approach where you only take into the supply side factors and completely ignore the demand side factors. The unified approach can be a starting point, but it is too little, too less to make really a headway. The future is that markets have to be given importance. And even if ALP remains in some point part of the time, probably the more focus would be on formulatory approach rather than sticking to the ALP itself.
Right. Oswalji, you've been part of the United Nations for many, many years, where you know, more diverse, more developing countries have given their voices. What's been your assessment as to where is the mood heading? Is there a more formula-based approach that's going to be the new normal?
Well, if you ask me today, it's not relevant. Whether I'm in UN or not, the developed countries are so powerful that they override everything what developing countries say. And developing countries don't speak at all, except few countries, two or three countries. That's the problem with the developing countries. In fact, they should create their own thinking and come out with the thought process and must share that and oppose something. They're in majority, but they work like a minority. That's the reality. Now, we are talking about these three approaches, three methods. What you are saying is, US follows formulary apportionment method in the domestic areas because there are 51 states and everybody want to have a share of cake of the revenues. It has worked very well for last 50, 60, 70 years. There's no issue. When it comes to the cross-border, they are still not happy with this method. They want to have, because they are part of the OECD, they are saying ALP. And ALP has been discovered by the five methods, which are purely theoretical methods, they have been discovered by OECD. Now, they themselves are finding it difficult in the digital world. It is impossible to come out with a result by ALP. And particularly India, China have been raising their voice on the subject and the litigations are bound to go up. We are not talking about far, we are talking about farm. M we are adding because we want the importance to the market also should be given. If the market is not given due importance, then it is lopsided approach, one-sided approach. And therefore, you are not getting allocating right, taxing rights to your country. And you see the best example which I remember in my committee, a Chinese officer came and gave, and that was an eye-opener for everybody. What he says, Apple is manufactured in India, in China, right? Now, of course, in India. Apple was manufactured in China. 60% of the cost of production was incurred in China, and therefore, 40% of cost, not on selling price, cost was intangibles, etc., etc. We don't care what profit you allocate to us, but we will tax 60% of the profit. Intangibles, which is, Americans said, sorry, it is an intangible which is very important. I said, there's no doubt it is important, but that is not everything. But based on your intangibles, your ability to precisely manufacture and continuously give you delivery is equally important. That skill we have got, our people have got. So therefore, you have to allocate the profit. So come, I'm just giving this example by way of understanding, because whatever rule which you create, developing countries will come out with some issues for that. So there has to be some allocation in a manner that give importance to the marketplace.
Right.
And that is the reason why if you look at the UN transfer pricing model, if you look at comparability chapter particularly, in that chapter, the contribution has gone from India and China substantially. We said locational saving. China said locational saving advantage. Then we have come out with the concept of locational rent. These are all things which are relevant. And that really gives the substantial or some attribution to the marketplace.
Right. Umang, you've heard the take from Mr. Williams, Ashish ji, Mr. Oswal ji. Representing the corporate, let me put the question in a different manner. You need to give certainty to your management. Would you prefer an approach where you will follow arm's length principle, discover the price, and maybe leave it for the litigation and in such a way that after 4 or 5 years, you will have a final answer? Or would you prefer an approach where the tax regulator tells you, okay, here is a X percentage, maybe it's not the best way, but you take it and on day one, you have a certainty. Which approach would you prefer as a business representative?
Sure, Ameya. So, coming from the industry, you have very rightly said what happens that ultimately I'm answerable to my CFO, whether it's the Indian CFO or the global CFO, is regarding the certainty factor. Having said that, to be very honest, specifically in case of India, what has happened is that we have time and time tested the approach number one. And to be very fair on this, there has been certain inherent limitations, you may say, or whatsoever, the subjectivity owing to which there has been a lot of litigation in the past. The second approach is something which definitely looks like to be more of a consistent approach, which is capable of bringing the certainty. But it has still to test the waters, because even if you refer to the draft rules on PE profit attribution, there's still a lot of gray areas which have to be addressed upfront. So till the time accompanied by that certainty and consistency, the clarity is there. So till that time, it would not be very easy to say that, okay, second approach is the best solution.
Okay.
So all the three have to accompany each other. And then I think moving from one to two, it's not a matter of switch on, switch off. It has to be a very gradual process. That's what I can say.
Right. Arijit,
if you remember, there is a section called 14A in the Income Tax Act. That is, you get an expenditure allowance for which is not part of the total income.
Sure.
Correct? So there used to be a lot of litigation because one is not sure which are the expenses to be allowed, which is an expense not to be allowed.
Right.
So initially what happened was it was a guideline being given, or thereafter what happened with the assessing officer made the ad hoc kind of a determination what is the expenses which to be allowed and not to be allowed. Now later on, after many amendments and after many litigations, the department or the legislature has come up with Rule 8D,
sure,
where there is a formula.
Sure.
So now people are more happy with the formula because they know what's the certainty as to what is the amount which will be disallowed under 14A.
Right.
So maybe this way as well.
Yeah, people are not happy. So yeah.
So it's a diverse view whether it's happy or not happy.
No.
So maybe that's the reason the combination of both the formulas will ultimately work.
Sure. No, which is why I think a lot of people have said that
three,
a combination is
three.
What is probably more appropriate. Moving forward, as I mentioned in my opening remark, Ashish ji, if you could take this part. We've seen implementation of DEMPE principles in the transfer pricing. In India, after BEPS, like we introduced some of the other measures like CBCR, we've not had any specific amendment to reflect BEPS action plan 8 to 10 in the transfer pricing rules. We've not had any modification. How do you see the OECD's new approach on DEMPE being implemented in the transfer pricing, and especially in some of the APAs that you are dealing with, both unilateral as well as bilateral?
You see, the first part that we didn't bring any change in the rules is that when the rules were being implemented, the core ideas which were there, that merely a legal owner should not get all the returns, that was being formulated by India in its TP assessments. At times, at the relevant time, we were being criticized of being over aggressive, but later on that principle was approved and it formed part of the guidelines or the BEPS action plan. So far as the rules part of it is concerned, it was already taking care of it, and that's why you didn't need any amendment to that rules. But coming again back to what impact it had had in APAs, I can say that two things have happened. Although our stand has been like that, but there has been a better understanding from the taxpayer perspective also that, okay, he is better able to explain the global team that this is in line with what the general consensus is. And in fact, in two APAs, in one clearly using the DEMPE functions, we have been able to conclude an APA where earlier it was being said that the parent entity had developed the IP, an Indian entity is only a service provider and therefore should get cost plus in India and everything else should go back to the parent entity. We were able to get almost a major portion of profits to be retained in India and a smaller portion going back to, otherwise earlier there would have been any recognition. It would have been the owner of IP taking everything. Second aspect was regarding the cashback, this cash box companies. There was a case where an entity was created in a jurisdiction through which an investment was made, but ultimately everything, all counter guarantees and everything were being given by the Indian entity. So we agreed to allow a risk-free return on the on the own capital of that entity. And that agreement which we could do. So that's why it's moving, and a perception is definitely changing. That's there.
Right. Oswalji, do you agree that it's only the perception change which has happened in India, or have you seen any client situations where recognizing Dempe, some specific changes have been done in the structure by your clients?
Yeah, absolutely, because now in the light of what has happened, OECD as well as United Nations, there's only difference is word A in between in Dempe. D-A-E-M-P-E in UN, D-E-M-P-E is in OECD. A stands for acquisition. Development, sometimes you can acquire the technology and then further exploit. So that's why we improved upon it. But in reality, if you look at, if you go by the OECD's BEF section 8, 9 or 10 was the case maybe, what they are talking is value creation. And then what they are talking is profit should be attributable where activities are. A core theme, if you keep in mind, Dempe is exactly that. Now, Dempe is where you have developed the property, where the intangibles you have developed, where the exploitation enhancement has taken place, where the maintenance has taken place, protection has taken place, and exploitation has taken place. So those all entities actually, this talks of reality. This doesn't talk of theory. What hitherto which was talked about was purely theory. Now, when we are saying that this is a reality, again, the OECD recognizes the principle that profit should be attributable to where activities are carried out. So therefore, and that global principle, if you look it at, it is very easy to lay down this principle. Therefore, it is important for a person to look at the reality, must understand the business. In India, the transfer pricing is, except the APA team, which has been doing genuinely what the transfer pricing should be seen. The assessing officer should like look at this in the same fashion. And I suppose if you look at the UK perspective of transfer pricing, they take up the few cases and they go into the business aspect thoroughly, study it properly. A team works on the whole business and they come out with the solutions. So which in India, an officer is doing 200 assessment of a transfer pricing, impossible for him to do that job.
Right.
And therefore, the OECD theory is that don't go by documentation, go by the conduct of the parties. What is that? Look at the conduct, who is doing Dempe development, who is maintaining, protecting, this, attribute the profit to that.
Right.
And who has spent how much money, look at that activity, that is the benchmark.
Right. Mr. Williams, the UK experience, have you seen any substantial changes in a post-Dempe world in the UK context?
2 points on that. First, to confirm that we did update our transfer pricing rules in the domestic law to reflect the outputs under the BEPS action plan. I think second, building on what Mr. Ostwal just said, there is a need now for businesses not just to rely on documentation. You know, it's much riskier, it seems to me, than it was to sort of do documentation and then do conduct which is at odds with the documentation. And I think that has led big groups to be much more concerned about substance. And they want the substance to be all in one place because they don't want uncertainty about how you then weight substance spread over a number of places. And I think you see probably that most clearly in things like, you know, management of brands, management of intellectual property, where before BEPS, you know, you fairly often saw cases where the legal ownership was in a tax haven, but the activities to preserve the IP, to develop, generate the IP was somewhere else. I think that's tending to disappear because, you know, it doesn't work as effectively in terms of how much you would remunerate the tax haven. Equally, it doesn't work as effectively in terms of the risks involved with it.
Right. And very quickly, other than the UK, the response from the tax administrations in the other parts of the world who have been some of your colleagues at OECD, are they sort of positive about the implementation of DEMPE in their own jurisdiction?
I think it varies. I think the extent to which it's fed through the system varies. If you look at the UK, HMRC, our tax administration, audits quite close to real time. And on that basis, by now, it will have seen tax returns and documentation reflecting the new reality. If you audit tax returns a few years late, you're only now, I think, beginning to see. So there's a sort of ripple effect. Some people see more because they have actually seen more cases. Other countries are perhaps thinking that there hasn't been as much impact, but it's sort of there and they will shortly see it.
Right. Arijit, you know, we've been talking about DEMPE, and as Ostwal ji said, OECD is asking us to look at the conduct and not the documentation. It's really the same version as substance over form. You've been looking at many of the transfer pricing cases that come before the court, and you've been the representative of the tax administration in many of these cases. If you could quickly share your experience on transfer pricing in the past few years, and hearing this conversation from, you know, in the last 20 minutes, how do you think the future disputes will come before the courts?
To add to this, I would mention, you know, there is this very sought after, looked after matter which is pending in the Supreme Court, which is on marketing intangibles, expenditure, how much is to be allowed.
Sure. So the department... Rohan Bhai touched upon it in the morning session
so,
today.
So what happened was, I am doing that matter for the department. So what happened was, the bright line concept was introduced by the department. So the bright line is going to determine what is the expenditure which has been incurred by the people in the country normally, in such kind of a scenario and industry. And anything which is beyond that bright line, those expenditure will not be allowed. So far as the Delhi High Court is concerned, it said this bright line theory is something which is strange to our kind of a income tax act. This theory is not prevalent. So the Delhi High Court has given a judgment in favor of the industry. But now the Supreme Court has seized of the matter, issued notice, granted leave, saying that it's a substantial question of law and therefore this has to be adjudicated. Whether the new concept of bright line theory which has been brought in is to be accepted or something similar has to be brought in, or whatever has been the claim of the industry as of now would be allowed and later on some new legislation would be brought in. Just like in the Vodafone matter, what the court said, we don't have a look-through provision at present. Therefore, transactions like Vodafone would be allowed at present, but if we had a concept like a some kind of a regulation to tax it, we could have taxed it. And that's the reason why the department brought about that retrospective law from 1961 to tax Vodafone, which is now presently in litigation, in arbitration.
Right. So again, substance over form, look through, look at...
It's always has been substance above form. Department says we need to look into the substance. What is the commercial reality?
Right.
What was the commercial necessity for bringing in this structure? Even in the Vodafone matter, what happened was, if you look at the structure was prior in point in time. Therefore, since one particular share was sold in Cayman Island, and the whole structure was there before the transaction took place, therefore, the court ruled in favor of Vodafone.
Sure.
But any structure which is brought in later on, which is shallow, hollow, which doesn't have that commercial reality or commercial necessity, that's what's to be looked in.
Sure. Ostwal ji, you want to quickly comment on this?
I really want to understand how the Supreme Court can rule on the pure economics. Economics, the effect of economics based on the facts and circumstances could be different in different situations.
Sir, it is the job of...
I want to understand, because I am very happy that you pointed out and we take advantage. But to take advantage of your presence here only, I am asking this question because I am not that intelligent as Supreme Court people are. Because you see, you are talking of, you know, you want to go in the market, you must negotiate in this fashion only. Marketing is being done in a particular country. Each country's headquarter will decide whether you want to capture this market in this country or not based on if your competition exists in the in this particular country, you will have to spend more money. If you are a new entrant, you will have to spend more money. If you are already in existing, now for example, let me give an example. The in toothpaste industry, Colgate spends more money than even Hindustan Lever and Procter & Gamble, who are also their competitor. Though Colgate is number one in India, having 57% of the market share, Colgate spend, the spending is huge, much, to retain their market share. Not to introduce new product, but to retain that market leadership. It is very essential. So does it mean that you are developing your foreign company's brand? And therefore, it should be disallowed. These are issues which need to be
addressed. Sir, therefore, it is always a challenge for the tax administration to look through the structures which are made by intelligent chartered accountants like you. Therefore, therefore, what the department says is we'll look at the interpretation which is strict in nature. Sure. Therefore, we are only going to look at the section and the words and what it is saying so far as taxation is concerned. And
sure.
Intelligent chartered accountants come up with structures which say we look at the purpose for why it was created and we go for the purposive rule. Therefore, it has always been from time immemorial, ever since the courts have started, it's a, whether you want to go for the strict interpretation or the purposive interpretation.
Yeah,
sometimes the court go for the strict interpretation, the department wins, and when they look at the purposive interpretation, the taxpayer wins. So
sure.
It's always been a seesaw battle between strict interpretation and purposive interpretation.
Right, fair point. I think Arijit wants to keep all his arguments for the Supreme Court and not really reveal them today. Moving forward, as I mentioned, we've been hearing a discussion on substance over form, look at look-through approach, and all of that has been now codified in the form of GAR. In the morning session today, we touched upon GAR versus PPT. Likewise, GAR and transfer pricing is going to be another area, especially in the next year's transfer pricing assessments. Very interestingly, in the last 6 months, there are two international judgments which I'm sure many of you would have read upon. One is the Canadian judgment in case of Cameco and the Australian judgment in case of Glencore. Essentially, both these judgments talked about recharacterization of the transfer pricing. And even in the Indian context, we've had some cases where tax officers try to seek to recharacterize the transactions and courts sometimes have sort of accepted it and in many cases courts have rejected it. That threshold gets enhanced substantially, and Ashish ji, if you could come in on this. Once the GAR comes in, there is also a codified form of law to sort of possibly restructure the transactions as well, even if they meet the arm's length test. Ashish ji, your take on how GAR and transfer pricing will interplay will work out. We know the CBDT circular and it says that both can coexist, but I think your take will be very interesting.
Now, like you are referring to the two international court decisions. Now, if people would have gone through it, they would realize that in the first one, which was the Canadian one, just I'm giving a snippet of that, and the thought process and how it impacts and why necessity of GAR and TP both being there. Now, in that case, the case was in the background of US-Russia agreement where the nuclear stockpile of Russia was to be dismantled and that uranium fuel was to come into the market. So this American and Canadian headquarter companies, they entered into an arrangement under which they were to take the whole fuel and then regulate it how it came into the market after doing the conversion of it. Now, what they did after the agreement was entered into, the whole supply and the marketing chain was put in place, then the Canadian entity created a Swedish entity, which was designated to be the trading arm. There were four people who were placed in Sweden, and they entered into back-to-back arrangement because the whole supply was to be taken and then resold by these entities. The huge profits were created in this Swedish entity. Canadian tax authority invoked the transfer pricing provision, and under transfer pricing provision, they recharacterized and brought back that, made the adjustment in the hand of parent entity in the Canada. That went into the Canadian Supreme Court. There, it's very surprising. The decision what the court says is, they say, if you look into the aggregated transactions, then the tax motive is very apparent. But when you are using transfer pricing, you have to break it into, there are identifiable separate transactions. And since each transaction can be benchmarked by applying a transfer pricing approach, and therefore you won't recharacterize it in the line of the overall scheme. And then they went on to say, there is a cup, it is being purchased, the independent party is also purchasing at that part, and they gave substance to the trading entity, saying that yes, being part of the global, part of the total group, it cannot act beyond the mandate of the group, but that doesn't make that it is a sham transaction. Now that's the philosophy. So far as purely transfer pricing, they said fair enough, transfer pricing rules apply, you cannot look into the whole scheme, you go by the transaction. Now that is something where a recharacterization on purely transfer pricing principles was negated. Now if you see in India, normally courts have, in fact OECD also before BEPS, its commentary also said ki recharacterization should not be done unless there were two specific circumstances which they had mentioned, which came in EKL appliances also and which was referred to in Sony case also. But the fact is that in BEPS, the mandate initially even in transfer pricing has been given that you delineate the actual transaction while taking into account the conduct. And if the actual delineated transaction requires, then certain transactions can be disregarded and you can disregard those transactions. So that mandate is still there. But even with these global positions being taken by the different legal authorities, GAR, since statutorily provides taking into account the overall scheme and also specifically for negating the tax benefit, it authorizes the commissioner to recharacterize the transaction or disregard the transaction. At times, if the transfer pricing provisions are not sufficient to address the real mischief which is being sought by a scheme, this would take care.
Right. Mr. Williams, your take on recharacterization in transfer pricing, is that something which is common in the UK that you've seen, or are the thresholds are very high? How UK has seen this?
I think what's common is that on the one hand you've got the transfer pricing guidelines, which certainly in the OECD version are fairly strict on when you can recategorize, coexisting with countries' domestic anti-abuse and anti-avoidance rules. I mean, in the UK, and treaties accept that, in the UK we have an anti-abuse rule which is, I think, distinctly narrower than India's GAR, but we also have the transfer pricing leg of our diverted profits tax, which in a sense is a form of recharacterization with quite specific rules. And I think probably we're going to continue with this duality between the transfer pricing guidelines and domestic anti-abuse rules, because I think otherwise how do you cope with the fact that countries have different practices in terms of what they will accept as substance, what documents they will look through, how they will regard one sort of evidence against another. There isn't an easy way of achieving uniformity in that. If you had a circular transaction, some jurisdictions, I think generally including the UK, would look through a circular transaction, other jurisdictions wouldn't. And I think it's coping with that sort of disparity that leads us where we are.
Right. Umanga, we discussed the tempeh and the additional sort of onus kept on the corporates to justify their conduct as well in line with the documentation, coupled with the fact that we also have a GAR that puts again a substantial responsibility as a corporate when you prepare your transfer pricing documentation. Any specific changes in the approach that you are contemplating with these two things happening simultaneously?
See, what is happening is that definitely with all these changes coming up, globally the trend is that we are trying to be more aware. Okay, and now the thing is that being a part of the global organization, you never know what you are reporting in one part of the world may immediately get attention in the second part. So it's bringing the world closer, and most of the corporates these days try to ensure that the positions which are being taken are consistent. So for example, what I may be offering for tax, under APA in one particular territory, it may be benchmarked by any other territory also. So that is what is happening. It's that that nexus, that closeness is coming up, and the documentation has to be like very much at par in each and every territory we are operating in.
Right. Arijit, in our pre-panel discussion, you touched upon possible constitution-related issues that may come up when we look at transfer pricing and GAR and which one overrides. See, very briefly, since we have a limited time.
There is a controversy going on as to whether GAR is going to override the treaties or treaties are going to override the GAR. So far as treaties are concerned, treaties are under Article 253 of the Constitution. Article 253 of the Constitution starts with notwithstanding anything in the foregoing. Right? And the GAR has been brought in by the legislature under section under Article 246. So 246 is before 253. Therefore, if you look at the constitutional provisions, the constitution provisions 253 says notwithstanding. Therefore, ordinarily the treaty should override the GAR as it was earlier. But there are certain conditions which have been put in which are to be followed. Like the treaty should have those LOP benefits, as in it should not have been, it should have those safeguards so that people don't take advantage to an extent which is not desired by a country to have given to a particular SSE. But again, if you look at section 92A, it again starts with notwithstanding. Therefore, 92 is before 92A. So therefore, it is an interplay of the Constitution as well as the Income Tax Act. Ultimately, it's the legislature has proposed something. It's going to be the court's work to settle it.
Sure.
Finally.
Sure. I think that's, of course, the last word, that we go to the courts to find the final answers. But before that, before we go to courts, we've seen a fantastic program of APAs in India over last over 5 years. As I mentioned, 300 plus APAs. Before Ashish Kumarji comments upon APA program, Oswalji, if you could give your experience around APAs, and also vis-a-vis some of the experiences that you've heard in the other parts of the world on the APA program, and what are the one or two things that are necessary to sort of improve upon the program. It will be very interesting, and then we'll have Ashish ji sort of give his response.
Well, I think we should give opportunity to Ashish to listen from him rather than my saying anything on APA, because APA is a program which is a dispute prevention provisions, which are very relevant and important. Most of the countries and statistics which have been published by the OECD inclusive framework, they said we are on par with the world. China had 5 years before, and we have caught up much later than them, and we have done much more APA, possibly will give us a number, much more number of APAs than China. So therefore, we sometimes our legislations have come late, but we are to catch up. Initially, you need to have capacity development. Once the capacity is developed, India catches fast. India had huge transfer pricing disputes from 2002 onwards. Reason being very simple, unless those disputes happen, the jurisprudence will not develop and the officers will not get trained. Now we are trained full force, we can give guide, we can go to the world and draft their transfer pricing regulations. In fact, our legislation on documentation is followed by a number of countries. Let us give an opportunity
sure,
for him to speak.
Sure, Ashish ji.
You see, it's a good program. It was well received, and the indications are that we are overwhelmed with work. That itself shows that there has been a big, good response to it. And again, the faith of taxpayers in this program being reposed is also derived from the fact that in past years, the agreements, wherever they were entered into, and whichever agreement were getting completed in this year, renewal in almost all the cases, renewal applications have been filed this year. So that shows a continuing process that people are really invested. We could have delivered far better results and far better satisfaction to the taxpayers. But like any government department, a new department always has resource constraints. We are working under those resource constraints. But equally, a good point about this program has been the taxpayers themselves. At times, they have taken a position in APA which is very different from what they are agitating or what they are litigating on the other side of it. Now, that is one thing which has led to success in this program because, and the second thing is again, what doesn't happen in transfer pricing audit at times is that people don't share information. They feel that what we would share, how it will be used, there is a bit of apprehension. In APA, in majority of cases, I don't say in all the cases, but in majority of cases, we have been fortunate that taxpayers have been open in sharing the information because of the environment where it is a more conducive environment. So that has been the basic cause of the success story of APA, which has been there.
Right. Yeah. Umang, quick comments on this.
Sure, sir. I totally concur with you coming from the industry side that it has been all about transparency and building the trust factor from both sides, to be very honest. So having said that, I think it's a fantastic program. And let us try to imagine a scenario that if like these 300 APAs would not have been there, what kind of litigation would have been there? So right. Undoubtedly, it's like excellent program. So my question to you would be still that, see, we have taken around like 5 to 6 years to reach to this figure of around 300. Now, out of these 300, as you said, it is quite likely that most of them would be coming up for renewals. So, sir, given the renewals, can we expect some sort of a fast-track program where we do not have to, like, wait again in the queue?
I also hope that we don't take next 5 years to do next 300. We'll do maybe a bit early. But so far as renewals are concerned, We will fast track them because we have the comfort of having seen the business, having seen the model, and if there is not much change in it, then the process would definitely be speeded up. And we are also interested in statistics, so the renewals give us a good statistics. Yeah.
Right. The time is up for our panel. We don't have time for the questions as well, but I think. After the panel, I think panelists will be available. We'll end on this positive note. Please give a big hand to all the panelists for sharing their insights.